What do you think a matrix is? Just a rectangular array filled with numbers, or maybe something more? Until now, we basically treated a matrix as an array of numbers, and we used the augmented matrix to solve linear systems. A matrix by itself also means something. Curiously to know what? Well, watch this video. We will do this using an example. We have our matrix A, 1, 2, 3, 1, 0, 1, and we have two vectors, 1, 1, 1, and 1, minus 1, 1. What happens if we compute A times 1 and A times x2? Well, A times x1 equals first component 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals 6, second component 1 plus 0 plus 1 equals 2, plus 6, 2, and A times x2, first component 1 minus 2 plus 3 equals 2, and second component 1 plus 0 plus 1 equals 2, so 2, 2. So, there we are. But what does this mean, this example? So what happened? Well, we had our matrix A. We had an X in R3. Then we put it, say, into the matrix A, and then we got an A times X in R2. So A works like an engine which turns vector R2 into a vector, which turns a vector in R3 into a vector in R2. But you know these types of engines, that you learned about them when you were studying functions. So A basically works as a kind of a function. And that's basically what A is. It's a prescription of a function T, which transforms vectors, in this case, from R3 into a vector in R2. So the M by N matrix A implements a mapping, a function from Rn to Rm, given by T of x equals A times x, where the collection of all input values, the domain of the function is Rn, given by this n over here, and the set in which all outputs lie, the codomain, is in this case Rm, and it's specified by this capital M. So the domain and the codomain are given by the sizes of the matrix A. And that is a very easy example. Transformation from R3 to R3. T of x is given by the matrix P times x, where P is this matrix which contains mostly zeros. So, and only ones over here and over there. Why did we call it P? Well, we will see that later. First, we compute, for example, T times x1 equals P times x1, because the mapping, the transformation is implemented by our matrix. P times x1 gives 1, 1, 0. And if we compute T times x2, we have to compute P times x2, and we get 1, minus 1, 0. So what happens to our vectors x1 and x2? Well, basically the first and second components are unchanged, but the third components are killed off, they are becoming zeros. So what happens to our vectors? We have a vector nicely in R3, and then we get the vector, the same one, but then with zero last component, something like this. So what does the matrix P do? Killing off all the last components means you're basically projecting on the x1, x2 plane. So now we can answer a few questions about our transformation T. Domain and codomain, that's always easy. You can see it from the size of the matrix. Domain of T is R3, and codomain is also R3. But in this case, you can also answer the question, what is the range of the transformation? You know from your calculus that finding the range of a transformation can be pretty difficult. Same holds here. But now you can see what the range is. Where can you come? Well, the transformation projects points on the x1, x2 plane, so you cannot go beyond the x1, x2 plane, so the range will be a subset of the x1, x2 plane. And if you are with your vector inside your x1, x2 plane, you will stay there, so you can get everywhere in your x1, x2 plane. So that means that those two together give you that your range will be the x1, x2 plane or the x in R3, such that the x3 equals 0. So now you have a better idea for what the matrix is actually doing. You can view a matrix as the implementation of some function from Rm to Rn. We can And we can often use this way to view matrices later on.